Welcome, everybody, to part two of the Funny Indian Show podcast. It is episode 33, and I'm sitting here with Sharat Raju. I had to get that twice. I had to make sure I got that. Where can people find you, by the way? What's a good Facebook, Twitter, website?
You can find me on Facebook if you just put in my name. And
Let's spell it for them.
Oh, it's S as in Sam, H-A-R-A-T as in Thomas. Mm-hmm. This is how I talk to people.
That's right. Absolutely.
And then Raju, R-A-J-U. I have a website, which is SharatRaju.com. And I'm about to finish a short film that's going to be on the next season of Future States.
Very cool.
And Future States is futurestates.tv.
Okay.
Like Future States, like United States, but futurestates.tv. Right. And my episode is going to air on, I believe it's April 16th, and it's called Worker Drone.
Okay.
And it's a sci-fi, PBS-funded sci-fi series. So.
Okay. Very cool.
It's pretty neat.
And then if people don't catch it live, they can catch it online?
Yeah, it's all online. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Futurestates.tv.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very cool. Yep. What is Future States? Can you describe
it? Yeah. So Future States is a PBS-funded science fiction series. Okay. That's the idea of the show is, series is, envision the United States in the near to distant future, taking into account changes in demographics,
sure.
Technology, society, politics, and so they approached this handful of filmmakers to come up with ideas based on this prompt. Season one has aired already, and season two, my episode is going to be airing in season two, and it's 18 minutes. And all of them are very interesting, innovative filmmakers who are doing some interesting work. And
that's awesome.
Anyway, it's kind of cool. And mine happens to take place in a call center in India, so.
Very cool.
All the other ones probably take place in the U.S. Mine takes place in the call center in India.
That's what sets it apart.
Yeah.
Very cool. Very cool stuff.
Which was shot in Los Angeles.
But it's shot in L.A., right?
Yeah.
Like outsourced.
Yes.
Yep. What do you think of outsourced? What do you think of the stuff that's on TV right now?
You know, I wish I don't have a real good educated opinion because I've only seen a few episodes, and I didn't like it, and it had nothing to do with it didn't really have anything to do with the way India was portrayed or any of that, because I think that was totally fine. I didn't find the comedy interesting to me. Mm-hmm. Now, I've heard that it's gotten better, mm-hmm. and I should probably give it another chance. Mostly, I don't watch a ton of television, mm-hmm. so it's I should keep up with it, but
sure.
I have a weird feeling because although I haven't found the comedy yet to be as good as some other shows on television that I like. I wanted to succeed to employ all my friends.
yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of us root for it for that reason.
I have a lot of friends who are writers or actors,
sure.
and I want them all to work. And I know people on the show who are both in front of and behind the camera, so
yeah.
I wanted to keep doing well.
No, that's fantastic. We're rooting for it in that regard, for sure.
Yeah.
Actually, that segues extremely nicely into the next question, which is, what could you give up most easily, and what would be the hardest to give up, books, TV, music, or movies?
Ooh.
It looks like TV is the easiest to give up and movies are the hardest, but you might throw me a curveball.
You know, I think that would be probably the easiest would be... Yeah, the easiest to give up would be TV. The hardest would be movies. You know, it would probably be easy for me to say books only because I'm not as good... I was an English major, so I read like crazy, and I love reading. And problem is I get so busy I don't do it, but when I do it... I was like, why don't I read all the time? I really enjoy reading.
That's how I feel every time I read.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to finish up a book now, and I was like, why am I taking so long with this?
That's so funny.
I should read this all the time.
What book? Which book is it?
It's actually called Terrible Splendor, which is a nonfiction book about a tennis match, which sounds like very boring, but a tennis match on the eve of World War II between a German guy and an American guy.
Uh-huh.
Which I thought the premise sounded interesting, and I'm always reading stuff like, would this be interesting to watch on the screen? And so mm-hmm. I got it. I'm reading it. It's kind of fascinating.
Do you do that naturally as a filmmaker? Do you, as you read, do you go, what would this make a good film?
Sometimes. You know, usually I try to read stuff and say, well, because when you read, I think you make a movie in your head. Anyway,
of course,
right?
Yeah.
So I now go the other. Sometimes I'll go the other way or like reverse engineer it and saying, what can I make into a film? Mm-hmm. And sometimes that's a little naive because usually it's like the great movies or books are already optioned to make mm-hmm. into movies. But yeah, I mean, sometimes I do that. And then sometimes I'll just read it and then I'll I'll go through and like, that would be really awesome to watch.
Yeah, no, very, very cool. I'm sure you got to obviously have a vivid imagination to do what you do. Yeah. Changing gears. What pisses you off?
Oh, man. There's lots of things. I don't know.
Yeah.
I think hypocrisy is the biggest thing. I think that's probably a lot of people answer something similar, but I think that's the thing that bothers me. Like, I don't mind if people are jerks, and I don't mind a lot of things, but hypocrisy and lying are sort of hand in hand. Mm-hmm. It's like, it's sort of saying one thing and doing something else, mm-hmm. and then not owning up to it. I think that is probably what pisses me off the most.
Mm-hmm.
That in traffic.
I know, that's really funny. L.A. is not a good place to live if traffic pisses you off.
It's actually traffic. I was just joking. I mean, that sucks, but, you know, when I'm such an NPR nerd that I just like, oh, I can listen to radio.
Well, you know, that's very true.
Unless it's like when I happen to be here in town and there's like the pledge drive. And then it's like,
pledge drive week is the worst.
It's terrible.
That is, it's like the reverse shark week. It's what everybody looks forward to.
Totally the reverse shark week.
Total reverse shark week.
It's like chum week, I guess.
What's the least attractive quality in a person? Would it be lying? Would it be hypocrisy?
Flatulence.
But
I think inauthenticity. I think there's a lot of, I think you run into this a lot in the industry, because everyone wants to make themselves seem like they're more important than they are.
Mm-hmm.
And I think frequently I'll talk with people who are talking in industry speak,
mm-hmm.
or they're talking in a way that makes them invulnerable. Like, you don't see any vulnerability, or you don't see anything mm-hmm. of an actual personality.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of that is self-defense, and a lot of that is you know,
insecurity.
But sure. I think that's something that bothers me, and mm-hmm. I find myself running into that more when I'm just talking to people who are like, I'll have meetings with producers or go mm-hmm. to the studio or something, and they'll be talking in the same sort of like indirect manner. Like if they don't like a script, they won't say it's not good and this is why. They'll say,
right.
No, yeah, we're going in a different direction
with it.
And, like, you know, be very, like, passive-aggressive crap.
I think sometimes they don't know.
Or sometimes they don't know.
Yeah, totally. and I don't mean that as a defense. I just mean that as in, like, that's kind of crappy. Like, they don't know their job.
They're waiting for
someone to tell, give them their opinion.
Or they can't enunciate it, you know. Or they don't have the skill set in which to enunciate it. And that's all you encounter all the time. It's like, yeah, it's just not working for me. And it's like, well, working is not really a word. Like, I know it doesn't. You don't find it effective, but tell me why you don't find it effective. Let's say, yeah, I just didn't feel it.
It doesn't know what it wants to be.
It doesn't know what it wants to be. Like, that's just nonsense, right?
Yeah.
It's total BS.
That was about 5, 6, maybe it was 7, 8 years ago. That phrase came into vogue. I just noticed people saying that a lot. I was like, it doesn't know what it wants to be. Like, yeah. That's a really
it's
a cop-out.
It's just saying nothing.
It's saying nothing.
Yeah.
That phrase doesn't know what it wants to be.
That phrase has no idea what it wants to be. Yeah, it's terrible. No, I mean, I had a producer. There's very rare cases of this, but I met a producer. I have a producer friend who is working on a couple of big shows, and I had a meeting with him today, and he's, like, from New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
He's, like, you know, in his 50s, and he said, like, I'm the best guy I'll ever fire you, because I'm going to tell you the way it is. And I love that. And that's
like the
way I grew up in Chicago. Like, guys will just, they don't beat around the bush. They sort of, like, get to the point.
Yeah.
They, like,
yeah.
And they'll be nice about it. I mean, they'll be, like, direct, but they'll be like, you're not a bad person, but this is why this stinks.
Yeah, totally.
That is totally refreshing. If the whole industry worked that way, it'd be totally different.
If the world worked like
if
that.
If the world worked a different world. But
I think
you rarely encounter that. And I think, you know, a lot of it is also the creative field. People are very sensitive, and they're sensitive, and also
I think they don't want to be the guy that they don't want to be the one who told Spielberg you'll never make it, tell the Beatles you'll never make it,
sure,
and then
totally.
Like, you know, then they're, you know, horribly wrong.
Yeah. And people want to be nice because they always want to be liked, and they think if you're not going to tell them the way it is, they may not be. I understand why people do it. It's totally understandable, but I just don't like it.
I get it. What are a few words to describe you?
Oh, well, handsome, obviously.
Handsome.
I mean, this is all radio, so podcast. You're not going to be
able to see it. That's the beautiful part about it. We haven't made a video yet.
So it's obvious that handsome is one of them.
Clearly.
That's
why I haven't made it into a video, because I'm not. Yeah. You know, that's
Can handsome and nerdy go in the same sentence?
You can be handsome and nerdy. I mean, why not? There guys who are handsome and nerdy.
Okay. Well, then I'm going to have to go nerdy. I don't know. I think the other one is sort of just...
Geek chic. Isn't that called geek chic?
Yeah.
I don't think that's
like Weezer, right? Mm-hmm. Weezer sort
Weezer, of yeah. Rivers Cuomo, it would be.
Yeah. I don't know. That's a good question. Boy, I should have read these before.
That's a hard one. What are a few words to describe you? It's kind of hard. They get progressively harder. So yeah. that's number six.
Yeah. I'm usually very determined, I guess. I'm very... I think stubborn and...
intractable.
Intractable. Ingrown.
Like a toenail?
Yeah. I think that's good. I don't know why. Ingrown. I don't know what it is. People can Let's figure that out.
Nobody has said ingrown.
Oh, good. I'm going to say ingrown, though.
Grown in. grown in. What would it mean to pull a U? Somebody said, man, that guy just pulled a Sharat. What would that mean?
I would say, what I usually do is I try to lower expectations and then destroy those expectations.
Oh, good.
And people are like, whoa. But usually I probably hit just above average.
Yeah.
And then they're like, wow, he blew this out of the water. So that's probably, that's pulling a Sharat.
That's smart.
Like, sort of underplaying it, like everyone, no one really expects anything. And all of a sudden, oh my God, that's amazing. That would be a Sharat, yeah.
That's really good.
But really, the amazing is really, like, if they would have said, this is going to be awesome, and then I made it just, like, barely awesome, they'd be like, that's okay. But that's, see, I don't do that. I go way low.
You go way, set expectations really low.
Totally.
But you don't want to be the guy that does that, because then that will destroy, actually, ironically, will destroy your game. Oh, he's the guy who sets expectations low.
It would finally fall apart. That is right. Then the skill is making that feel organic.
Yes.
The bar has been set low.
Absolutely.
The expectation has been set low somehow.
Somehow. Yeah. Every single time.
Yeah. That would be pulling a Sharat.
Under promise, over deliver.
Exactly.
That's what they say.
That's right.
That's the name of the game.
That's the name of the game.
That really is the name of the game. I like that. See, that was a hard question and you answered it.
Oh, no, because I was, yeah, that one. That's a classic. That's a classic Sharat, yeah.
Who in pop culture or literature most closely resembles you? Have you ever watched a movie, read a book, went, wow, that's me on a page. That's me in that movie.
Oh, God, I don't know. No, I don't know. I don't think there have, not because I'm so unique, but I feel like I find myself reflected in some facets in lots
right.
of people.
Sure.
You know, so it's hard to, that's hard to say. I would say no, that I don't think I can name one specifically.
Yeah.
Because I would say something like Holden Caulfield. But
I was going to say, that's my answer.
Yeah.
And it's the most, but it's funny, it's so cliched
that.
Because everybody
but everyone has,
because
everyone
that's
has
what, that's
something
exactly.
they feel like that.
Exactly.
Yeah. But I don't think that would be accurate either, because that's not exactly how I would say it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. I'm going to punt, I guess.
I'm going to punt. No, Holden Caulfield is my default answer to it, but I think it's a lot of people's, and that's why the book resonated with folks. But it's still my favorite book, and it's kind of childish to say, or adolescent to say, because most people outgrow the teenage angst, and I felt like I've outgrown that in my life, but like people are like, oh yeah, it was my favorite book when I was 16, 17, but not now. Like, there's mm-hmm. another book, like The Fountainhead or Atlas Shrugged or some other like more mature book where they're just like, yeah, now this is more my kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I'm like, man, I don't know if I've ever... Even still, when I've read the book, no joke, probably 30 times.
Mm-hmm.
And every time I read it, I'm like, I still... Like, I don't feel like I'm as jaded as mm-hmm. that guy is. But I feel like his point of view, I'm like, man, he's just... He hates phoniness. That kind of gets back to your part about hypocrisy, and he hates phoniness. He loves real stuff. And
well, and he gets sort of... He gets... Once he's sort of put in a position to try to be an adult, he clearly... is more of a child.
Like, yeah.
And he's sort of disappointed with the adult world in a way.
Absolutely.
And I think that's all, like, totally what you can get is, like, if you're someone who's still considers themselves childish.
Yeah, very much an idealistic kind of guy. And we in one of our acting classes, our teacher, Kirk Baltz, he said that. He goes, I want you in this next exercise to behave like a child. But he goes, I don't want you to be childish. I want you to be childlike. And was like, wow, you're right. There's a huge difference mm-hmm. in those two.
Yeah.
The childish would be like playing with people and pulling their hair and running. Yeah. He goes, I don't want you to be childish.
Yeah.
It should be childlike. There's a natural quality to it. There's an innocence about it.
Well, there's probably a turn when you're a child when you go from feeling like you're in charge of everything because people will answer your every whim to then not having anyone listen to you or care about your opinion.
Yeah. You know? That's funny, which is adulthood in general.
Yes.
That's very true, I think. When Hollywood makes a movie about your life, or when you make a movie about your own life, who will play you?
Oh, it's got to be Cal Penn.
you got to go with Cal Penn.
I got to go with Cal. Well, Cal, you know, Cal is a friend, and he was in my first film. And, I had someone mistake me for him, and I think they were blind or drunk, I don't know.
But, they were stoned, more appropriately.
Yeah, so I'd have to say Cal, yeah.
That's fantastic.
Well, I mean, I got to give the role to him, yeah.
He's one of the guys. I mean, made a splash before the post Slumdog boom. I mean, this guy was huge. And
well, I have to tell you, this is a funny story related to Cal. So we
good because one of the questions I ask is, what's the story you could tell if you're throwing a cocktail party and it runs dry? So you're telling a story. This is good.
All right. Well, this might be not. Well, this could feel maybe that.
No, set expectations low.
Low expectations. Okay. Well, I wouldn't say it's that kind of story. So Cal, you know, was in my short film, American Made, my first film. Uh-huh. It was my thesis film coming out of AFI. And it's all about a family stranded on the side of the road, the desert, in the Grand Canyon. And he played the older son. And we wrapped it. And then a couple months later, we all had just a casual gathering at someone's house. And he was like, hey, you know, I'm up for this role. It's between me and this other guy in Canada, I think, for this role, and it's by the Dude Where's My Car director. Mm-hmm. It's about these two stoners who are looking for White Castle. And I was like, Cal, that sounds terrible.
Hilarious.
I was like, terrible. You can't take that role. And he's like, I don't know. I mean, it's a pretty funny script. It's a pretty funny idea. I'm like, no, you just can't do it. I mean, this goes back
to the guy who tells Spielberg, this will never work.
And he's like, oh, you know, whatever. And then it shows what I know. It's made him a huge star. Like, he can't walk down the street without signing autographs, right? And it's like, it made a great career. And after it came out, I was like, I don't know what I'm doing, do I? And no one knows what they're doing.
Nobody knows anything. I firmly believe that's the philosophy of the week that I've been trying out, actually, for the last month or so. But a friend of mine told me that he just had dinner with Cal Penn, I think it was like last week or the week before, and he's been a good friend to me. Like, he's hired me for a couple gigs and all that kind of stuff. He goes, I'd love to get the two of you together. I'm like, yeah, that would be cool. But he said that he's walking down the street with him, and he said, man, I mean, he was going to a restaurant, and still people are like, oh, really? Why, there's no White Castle burgers here, Cal. It's like, really? Like, still?
It's
like,
amazing.
How could people not, like, how would people not know that he would find that annoying as all get out? I mean,
and
he said he was really gracious about it. He said he was really nice.
I know, he's a sweetheart. And, in my film, the one who plays his mother is Sakina Jaffrey, and Sakina was cast in an episode of something that an episode of something that Cal was a guest star. I think it was Law and Order or something.
Yeah.
And she was actually playing his mom again. And he said, like, the entire crew got his autograph. And she's like, you can't believe this guy. Everyone's getting his autograph.
It's so funny. That's
great.
So great.
Yeah, great.
I mean, it really built a career. And then he went to go work in the...
And now he's in the White House. Exactly.
He's in the White House. Not White Castle.
I know.
White House.
Soon you'll be president.
Craziness. Craziness. Continuing the movie theme. In the movie Groundhog Day,
mm-hmm.
Do you watch Inside the Actor's Studio?
I've seen it a few times. I don't watch it regularly.
I James Lipton, he has a certain cadence. And
yes.
This is my James Lipton question, because I wrote it, but I feel like I like to ask it like he would ask
it.
Yeah,
so. Yeah, sure.
In the movie Groundhog Day, Bill Murray has to live the same day over and over. He fantasizes about a great day he once had. If you had to pick one day or one moment in your own life to live over and over, what would it be? What, Sharat, is your Groundhog Day? I love asking it like that. It's so silly.
God, it has to be PG also.
Yeah. Well, you know, the telling of it has to be PG.
Right.
The act could be NC-17.
Yes. I don't know that either. That's a good one. I don't know what that would be. God, I have a really lame answer.
Day you proposed to your...
Oh, that's a nice day, but I don't know about over and over again. Because, I mean, it was all about the surprise, really.
Right.
I don't know. I mean, it's hard to choose because I had... I don't know. The first thing that comes to mind is like, so in high school I played high school football, and I was actually a pretty good player. Which is surprising.
That's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. And I actually almost played in college at a small school, but I ended up going to Michigan, which is a big school, and I didn't play football there.
That would have been amazing.
That would have been
Rocky Bishmile. Yes. I would have been like, oh, that's pretty damn amazing.
Yes. I mean, I had one game. We had one game that I was like, nothing could go wrong. I could do nothing badly, and I would say probably that would probably be
what position did you play?
I played cornerback and wide receiver.
Oh wow, offense, defense.
I'm a short, fast
Deion Sanders, man.
Yeah, well, you know, in high school, it's I couldn't fathom doing that now. I'm just do not have that.
That's amazing. I mean, that's a pretty big position.
I guess so. I mean, it was more that we didn't pass a lot, so I didn't do a lot on offense, but it was more on defense. But yeah, so I was pretty athletic. So I think probably something like that, and I probably had a game like in I also played basketball, so I'm sure in basketball I had something like that. But those are always great because you feel like you're invincible. So when you have a great game and when you have a great day sporting, you just mm-hmm. never want it to end.
I could believe that.
You know, as an athlete, because you think like you just sort of feel like
you're just in the zone.
Yeah, nothing can really destroy you. Yeah. And I think that's like a feeling you want to accomplish when you do anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that would be a great day to live over in. Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. That's pretty awesome. Yeah. In the movie,
what do people usually answer?
People don't have an answer for it. It's probably the only question that I don't have an answer for.
Yeah.
Of my own, like where I don't answer my own
questions.
I'm
not totally satisfied with that answer, but I think it's actually pretty good.
It's a good answer. I don't answer my own questions on this, but just to say that it is a, because it's kind of vain to do that, but I do feel like that is a good one. Mine would be somewhat similar. I didn't play high school football, although I know that it looks like I probably was the center on the team, clearly. Right. If not guard or tackle. It would be similarly, there was a sporting event in my past where everything seemed to go well and all that sort of stuff, and I can relate to that. In the movie Office Space, Peter Gibbons, you've seen the movie, I'm sure.
Oh, sure. I love Office Space. That's one of my favorite comedies of all time.
That's a great comedy.
Yeah.
Do you know Ajay? Neither.
You know, it's funny because we have a lot of friends in common, but I've never met him.
Yeah.
Yeah, and everyone says he's wonderful.
I've heard he's a really nice guy. Peter Gibbons says his high school guidance counselor asked him what he would do all day if he had $1 million.
Right.
I guess now it would be like Austin Powers, $100 billion. Let's just say you're independently wealthy. If money were no object, what would you do all day?
What would I do, like, in one day, or, like...
What would your life look
how
like?
How would I spend my days?
Yeah, how would you spend your days?
It's weird, because it's hard for me to imagine my days would be terribly different, because...
That's a good thing to be able to say.
Yeah, because I'm really thrilled that I wish I was, you know, making films at a much bigger level, but
sure.
I'm really happy that I'm able to do what I do already.
Right.
I think with $1 million, it would make, like, you know, student loans go away, and credit mm-hmm. card loans go away, mm-hmm. so that would be nice. But, I don't know what I would do material, because I'm not someone who can just be, can laze around by the pool. I just don't have that. It doesn't interest me.
Yeah.
And I don't know if there's anything I like doing other than conceiving stories and writing them and trying to make them. I think that's, like, awesome. That's, like, fun.
Yeah. it's a great thing to be able to say.
Yeah, I'm lucky, you know. I'm totally,
very lucky.
I'm totally fortunate. Grateful.
Yeah, no, that's pretty awesome. I think a lot of people in the creative fields, they have that answer.
Sure.
Where they'll go, well, I am kind of doing what I would do.
Right.
And that's a pretty cool thing.
Yeah.
But you've been doing it long enough, though, now, where it's not like you're a dilettante.
That's right,
you know,
exactly.
You're in it to win it.
Exactly. You know, it's I would do it for nothing, which is basically what I do now. And then I would do it if people were paying me. And that's actually, you know, we had... at AFI, my year before I graduated, at graduation, they had Tom Hanks was getting a Lifetime Achievement Award from AFI. And AFI has one of the biggest Lifetime Achievement Award, or most prestigious ones in the industry. And so he got an honorary degree, so he came and gave a lecture at school.
That's pretty awesome.
And it was more like just an interview, like a Q&A and stuff. And he was great because he was like, everyone thinks like I'm successful, but the dirty secret is they could pay me nothing. I would do this for nothing.
Yeah.
And it's because I love it. And that's like, and that's really the way, if he's at that level, and maybe he has the luxury of saying that, but I think he actually earnestly believes that, and I think
no one
is going to offer him zero.
Sure. It's a safe thing to say at this point. It can be a dangerous thing to say on your way up, but I think that people like to hear that kind of passion.
Yeah. Where
it's like you are doing what you want to do, and you it is organic, and you're feeling like you are self-actualizing or whatever.
Yeah.
You're not just... I think, I know, I definitely know some guys in stand-up who... I know a lot of artists, but I know some guys who are really just doing it for the money. And
stand-up?
Yeah, and that's my reaction. I'm like, if you want to be... I was like, man, be an eye banker, be even a doctor, be something where it's like you're guaranteed to stack. Like,
yeah.
stand-up is really not a great place to go to if you want to make a lot of money. I mean, it can be, but it's not the first thing that comes to mind.
Yeah.
And I find it really curious. But I also think it's, you know, there's some guys who are kind of idiot savants, and they're really brilliantly talented, but they kind of shy away. It kind of goes back to what we were saying about, like, knowing your way around an office or a set or that skill set, so to speak. Sometimes is conflicted with people who are really, really, really bright, really, really talented, and they don't want to be the guys who are barking and handing out flyers or creating Facebook events or doing all the other things that you really kind of have to do now. Mm-hmm. If you want to be successful, we're talking about the ease of making films, and same thing with stand-up. You could just shoot it and put it online, but because it's easy, the barrier to entry has gotten so low.
Right, so many more of them.
Oh, there's so much clutter out there. And, you know, they don't want to partake in that and go, well, I don't want to be a guy who's just, like, posting stuff online. And it's like, hey, man, I can respect that you want to develop the craft, but there's really not another way to make it anymore. I mean, you can wait for Leno or Letterman to call you, but oftentimes they're going to be like, send us a link of what you do. Again, show, don't tell.
Yeah, right.
It is pretty cool when you meet people who answer it the way that you did.
Yeah, yeah.
I like million-dollar questions. What are you really good at? For example, let's say there's $1 million sitting on this table. What game are we playing? What do you you challenge me to a game of what?
As a game?
And it could be anything. It doesn't have to be a traditional game. It doesn't have to be ping pong. It could be, I know a lot about duck-billed platypuses.
I have really random... I'm just good at trivia.
Okay.
So, like, I have really just random knowledge.
Yeah.
So I would say trivia.
Star Wars trivia.
Star Wars would definitely be one of the top games. Like, if the category is, like, Star Wars... I like the Chicago Cubs.
Well, that's the question I go, if you could choose the categories on Jeopardy, what would you choose? So you're leading right, that was my next question.
I was almost on College Jeopardy when I was in college.
Really?
Yeah, I almost made it to the regional taping. I was like, at Michigan, they had the bus come around, and so I'm like, oh, Jeopardy's on campus. So I went in, like, I made it to the round right before you go to regional taping. So I'm nerdy.
That's pretty sweet. Cubs, Star Wars.
The categories, I would say Star Wars, Chicago sports, movies. Uh-huh. Movie 80s movies quotes. Probably that those in that range of general.
Yeah.
Probably like Academy Award winners. Yeah, things like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. directors.
What's the address of Wrigley Field?
It's 1040 West Addison. 1050 West Addison?
1060 West Addison. 1060 West Addison. That's a Chicago Cubs and an 80s movie.
And also
reference.
From Blues Brothers, yeah.
Yeah, Blues Brothers, that's exactly right.
1060 West Addison.
Yeah, cute. That's amazing.
Yeah, I love Blues Brothers, one of my favorite films. So.
It was my first favorite movie. My dad taped it for me when I was 9. He goes, I got a movie that you're going to love, and I watched it a million times, the car chase scene and whatever. And I actually did not see the unedited version until much later. I saw the TV version. And I thought it was much better when they were like, shoo. I was like, that's so funny that they said it that way. I was like, why did they say it that way?
But the scene with the nun is much different then.
Yes,
like,
it is.
She's slapping him.
And I'm like, why is she slapping him? That joke was lost on me.
How weird is that? Yeah.
There's like, all he said was up the creek. I'm like, what, is that bad? Should I not say up the creek in third grade tomorrow? But yeah, 1060 West Addison. And I was going to ask you something else about, what year did the Chicago White Sox throw the series to my Cincinnati Reds?
It's 1913. Right.
I think it's 1919.
It's 1919. 1919, yeah. It's 19. I also think it's 1913 because the White Sox, I think, won it in 1913 also.
Oh, okay. It's easier for me to remember.
It's 1919, which is also another movie trivia because that's 8 Men Out.
Eight Men Out?
Yeah, you haven't seen 8 Men Out?
No.
8 Men Out is a John Sayles movie about the Black Sox scandal.
Right on.
It's actually, you don't have to be a baseball fan to watch it. It's a great film.
Just like you don't have to be a Bieber fan to see Never Say Never.
Right, exactly.
I
just chose to, you know?
That's fantastic.
I actually just said this is another tangent.
Yeah, let's do it. Well, the second half can run longer, we can wrap it up in a couple minutes as it winds down, or we can go longer.
Well,
so
I just had just a quick aside because of the Bieber thing.
Totally.
I had a meeting with the company that made the Bieber film.
Nice.
Yesterday, I think. And I had to, like, have a semi-serious conversation about the Justin Bieber film. And it was like, okay, I don't know. I can name one of the songs, and I know I've heard parts of them, and I know he looks ridiculous and the whole thing seems ridiculous, but why am I having a conversation about this film? Like, it actually makes sense. Like, this is ridiculous.
That's really hilarious. You have to, like, take it seriously.
I was like, yes, interesting. Tell me more about how you made this film about Justin Bieber.
That's so funny. It's been pretty successful, I would imagine.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's crazy. They made it for, like, $20 million, and they made the entire budget on opening weekend. So, yeah. That's successful.
It's the Titanic.
And that's
effect.
Even way before it's going to be on DVD, obviously. Yeah. I mean, who knows how many kids are going to watch it in the future. Ugh.
Or on Future State. Probably not on Future State.
Probably not on Future State.
Probably not a thing like that. They'll watch it more than one time, which is a joke you don't get because you don't know the song One Time by Justin Bieber.
God, I do actually think I know what you're talking about.
Do you use your college degree? I guess you do. You went to film school. And undergrad, you English
major. I was an English major, yeah. And I also did film a lot. But I was a writer in college. I was a reporter in college for the student newspaper. And I think I use that a lot more in just narrative structure. It's right. a lot of training in how to tell a story. But I think in English, the one thing that English majors get bagged on for a lot, which maybe is justified or not, but I think one thing that it actually was really worthwhile is that you really learn text, how to analyze text, which is all what you do when you get a script. You really are looking at the story, you're looking at themes, you're looking at plot, but also, you know, bigger elements of how character evolves. Mm-hmm. And that's something that, like, I know when I moved to LA after college, people were talking about this is important. I'm like, well, isn't that the way you just read something? Mm-hmm. And I think I didn't realize I had learned so much as an English major, just reading a lot and having to write about it. And so when I read a script, or if I read a book, or if I read something that I think might be a good movie, I'd basically do a report on it, like I do what I did in college. And I think that's something that I'm very thankful for, that I had a lot of prep in. And then I also, did do a lot in film in college, so I use that too. Yeah.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, I'm taking.
I was also pre-med.
So, oh, right. Well, I was.
So too. I didn't. So I because well, you're Indian.
And of course.
So you're born pre-med.
You have.
So I didn't. So I haven't used that as much as you would imagine.
No, not nearly as much. Maybe I'll play one on TV, as they say. But no, I in sketch writing at UCB at Upright Citizens Brigade.
Yeah.
I mean, it's funny.
Well, you know Matt Walsh?
You know, it's funny, I just exchanged emails with him.
We went to the same high school.
It's funny, I just met somebody in Cincinnati at General Electric who put me in touch with him, and then we exchanged a couple of emails, and I need to email him again.
He was UCB, right?
He was one of the founders. He's one of the four founders.
His sister is my classmate. Like, I know her, I mean, we were pretty
close. Yeah, Chicago. He's from Chicago, yeah.
Yeah, he's from, he went to Hinsdale South High School in Darien.
That's so, and so you know him.
Well, I haven't, it's weird because I when I moved here, they're like, oh, Ann's brother's in film. And now he's like in everything, right?
Yeah, I mean, now he's on Outsource, he's in a lot of things.
Yeah, yeah.
Bring it back to that, yeah.
And then I've never crossed paths. But he does the Chicago Bears fan podcast.
Oh, that's funny.
Which is, like, totally unrelated to, like, entertainment. It's purely just fanboy geek stuff. And I haven't actually, I've only listened to that a few times. But, yeah, no, it's weird. We just, our paths are never crossed, but we, like, we grew up in basically the same general neighborhood.
Well, he said come down and see a show sometime, so I go to UCB shows a lot, so maybe
we'll
go check it out. It'd be a lot of fun.
I think he's great, yeah.
That'd be fun. It's really good. I was saying UCB. Yeah, it's funny. You're talking about being able to break things down and just keep them simple. And, you know, oftentimes at UCB, it's about the game of the scene, which is really just the unusual thing that becomes a pattern. And it's so funny when, you know, we'll go through a sketch or something that somebody wrote, and the teacher will ask a very simple question: what's the game? And the inability to answer the question is profound why the sketch isn't working, because you're not able to articulate what it's about.
Right.
What is the basic idea? Like, I'm writing a one-person show, and even after months and months and months of working with my director, he asked me four fundamental questions, and I won't bore you with all of them, but two of them were, what are you telling us and why are you telling us this? Mm-hmm. And I've always looked at why are you telling us this as the theme. Like, why is this work made? Why is it being presented to us? And he goes, I get the why. He goes, I still don't get the what. And I've been working on this thing for about 9 months.
Sure.
And he goes, I still don't know what you're telling us.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how being able to distill it down to that.
Well, that's all foundational, because once you have that, then everything sort of flourishes.
Everything flows.
Yeah. And I mean, that's like, and I mean, along the same lines, like, I'm now working with, at Yale Law School, I'm helping this documentary film initiative through the law school. And they, much of what we're doing is basically like a lot of my training in just in journalism. It's all like, this is a story. I mean, here, like when I was a sports reporter actually, and and that was my first job actually after college too. And it is fascinating because you have an event and everyone has seen the event usually, like especially when I was covering the football team in Michigan, but. You have one thing that everyone's referring to, but then you have other people's like inferences of what they think, and then you have statistics, but then you also have quotes. So that's all like that's like in editing a documentary for me.
Right.
It's been like you have an event that everyone is sort of talking about, and then you have people's interviews that are sort of like quotes, like the post game quotes,
and then
you have analysis, which is sort of like the game statistics, and you sort of put all that together, and it's very much like well, what is the story? You know, like what do you tell me what the story is, and then build it from there. But it's really all that foundational stuff is it seems simple when you see it work together, but it's a lot of work getting to it. And then building off of that.
Yeah. It's a ton. It was just like in the scientific method. I was an engineer, but of course we all learned the scientific method in 6th, 7th grade, whatever, science fairs and all that jazz. And I remember, it's so counterintuitive because our science teacher said, there's like a 6-step process. And the first step, 5 or 6, I think it's 6, the first step is define the problem.
Right.
And he said, you will spend more time on this step than any of the other 5. And we're like, no, that can't be. How hard can it be to define the problem? And if you really do it right, that is a step that takes you, because you're like, what are we really trying to focus on and learn? What are we trying to prove? What are we hypothesizing? And it's like, wow, that is, it's amazing how the basics can take you the longest time. But you're right. Once you nail that, everything just, you can just create.
Yeah. And like for me, like screenwriting, when I write a script, the hardest is the outline, because that's the heavy lifting. It's like getting... And the outline for me is very dry. It's like, this happens, this happens, this happens. But that part is the hardest, because you have to, that's all structural. That's all the skeleton.
Exactly.
And then the dialogue and everything else is like, that's why you sort of wrote it anyway. So you already kind of have that. But then once you have the skeleton, then you can drape all the flesh around it. But without that, otherwise you just have jellyfish. I mean,
that's exactly how the development of the One Person Show has been.
Yeah,
I went off for a hiatus one weekend, 4 days. I took 8 days, but I wrote single space Times New Roman 12-point font, 85 pages. Just
oh my god!
And even authors, writers are like, dude, that's a lot of content. They're like, double space. You wrote a book, basically.
Yeah, totally.
And I'm like, yeah.
How do you even get through all that?
one of my best friends, he just goes, I can't believe you can write that much about one aspect of your life. He goes, if I had to write my entire 34 years, he goes, I could maybe fill 5 pages. He goes, I don't know how you could sit there and write that much. And I'm like, yeah, it's crazy. And then the second hiatus was to put that structure in it and go, okay, what really happens? And now it's like, okay, let's. Come up with the active title and, like you said, drape the flesh around it, whatever else. Because that's what my director said. He goes, I read it. He goes, it's smart. It's witty. He goes, I get that. He goes, but I am lost as to what exactly it is you're trying to say.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, man, this sucks. Like, it's such a hard... It doesn't suck. It's a fascinating process.
It's, part of
it's
it,
a ton of work, though.
Yeah, but it'll be worth it. We'll get it, and then it'll be... That's otherwise, it'll be... It wouldn't be as good if you didn't ask those tough questions.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. If it's just a hodgepodge of bullet points and but without a narrative, the narrative is really what ties it together. But if you're like, here's a presentation on whatever you want to talk about, those are a lot easier than being able to tell a story that actually fits together and makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Have you seen the movie Magnolia?
Yeah.
I just went back and saw it last night.
I haven't seen it since I lived in L.A.
Oh, wow.
Which is
coincidental in a way.
Yeah.
Did you live in the Valley when you saw it?
No, I mean, I've never lived in the Valley, but I saw...
You live in Venice?
When I saw it, I was not even in Los Angeles,
I
think.
Okay,
I must have been still in Chicago.
Yeah, it came out in 1999. I went back and saw it just 2 days ago because I've been wanting to rewatch it. And I don't know, the first time I saw it, I was just like, wow, this is amazing. But when I saw it again, I was like, wow, it is kind of a mess, though.
Yeah, I remember it being a little bit of a mess when I watched it, but I mean, I did enjoy it, but like... Frogs? Oh, no.
The frogs were amazing.
Is this next question related to Magnolia?
It's not, but we were just talking about the idea of structure and movies.
It is a mess. I mean, all those films, all his stuff and all Robert Altman's stuff sort of like shatters the idea of like structure in some ways because it's all like, but those are hit or miss. I mean, sometimes they're really great and they work really well, but sometimes they're like,
kind of like, well, I missed the mark. Yeah. I mean, I still like it. I just thought it was... But there's always the thing that's like, to break rules, you have to know them.
Yeah.
And otherwise, it is just kind of a mess. Yeah. Who has it figured out?
Who has it figured out? Boy. I mean, the easy answer is sort of Spielberg. But I do think he's a genius. I do think he has it figured out. But, you know, I have a very good friend who is the head of production at Funny or Die, Michael Farah.
Yeah.
And he's a couple years younger than me, but he moved out. His brother and I are good friends from college, and then Mike and I are good friends here. And he at one point, he was an intern at he was a junior agent at UTA, and then he was a producer at for Stephanie Lame. And he was, like, he just knew how the industry worked, and it's like, he was like Neo in the Matrix. Like,
that's
he just
funny.
Saw how it happened, how it all operates. I'm like, yeah, he knows. He's got it figured out. And he then was the first ever outside hire by the Funny or Die people to be their producer. Now they're the biggest. They're basically running a full studio there. They have 30 employees, and they make 20 films a month for Funny or Die. It's unbelievable. I mean, that's like almost a film a day. It's amazing. And that's all because of Mike. And he was just in the Hollywood Reporter for like 30 producers who are 30 or under or something.
Oh, that's great. 30 under 30 kind of thing.
Yeah. And so he's got it figured. He's one of my friends who's got it figured out. But I think Spielberg's got it figured out. I think like Tom Shadyac has got it figured out. I just heard him on NPR.
Okay.
You know, he directed Bruce Almighty, Liar Liar,
okay.
Ace Ventura. And then he like sort of like hated the way Hollywood operates, so he's like, you know what? I'm just going to give everything up and live in a trailer park in Malibu. And he's like, I don't need a
trailer park in Malibu. Those don't seem to go together.
Yeah,
that's really funny.
Yeah, there's a pretty famous trailer park now. Is he in the one in Malibu? There's one in Malibu and one in Topanga Canyon, but okay. I think he's the one in the Malibu. And I only heard part of the interview, but he was like, the way, like, I had a lot. I was successful in Hollywood. I am successful in Hollywood. But the way your condition is, you have to always want more. You have to always keep striving for more. But I was already at the top. I was already doing well. Why did I keep needing to, like, keep adding on to that? And so he's like, at one point you realize that you didn't need to do that anymore. And I thought that was pretty amazing.
That is pretty amazing.
Yeah.
That is pretty well believed. I mean, obviously, he had nothing left to prove. I mean, what does he
have
to prove?
Those are exactly.
Huge movies.
Yeah, he doesn't have anything to prove. And so he has something new coming out. It's something. Because his films all sort of have a spiritual component to them. And he has something that's similar to that and a comedy with some big stars that's coming out soon. And I think this is partially why he's doing the interview. But it was pretty interesting. But that's a good question. I think there's probably more people that would have it all figured out. But
no, that's great. Those are fantastic answers. Yeah. And specific to the genre, because a lot of times people go outside of that.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
That's
Gandhi. I don't know.
Yeah, Gandhi, Oprah. I get Oprah a lot.
Yeah,
I get
sure.
God a lot. Are things in the world getting better or worse?
Well, I don't know. I mean, that's tough. I think it sort of goes in both directions. I think there's some things that get better, and so I think overall things get better.
Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, things keep the great ML, the Martin Luther King quote, the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And I think a lot of things continue to bend towards justice, but it's a slow bend.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, but there are still things that are pretty awful. So it's, but I mean, even think about like in the U.S. I mean, even the fact that we have an African-American president is pretty amazing. I mean, that's kind of amazing. And then, but is that to say there's no Islamophobia in this country? No, it's outrageous.
Sure.
You know, I made a film called Divided We Fall in 2007, 2008. We released it on DVD. And it's about post-September 11th hate crimes. And that was, like, it was supposed to be slightly contained. It was in the immediate aftermath of September 11th. And, you know, we thought, well, you know, things are getting better. It's been time since September 11th, but it's not true. I mean, there were just two elderly Sikh men who were killed in Northern California.
When was this?
Just 4 days ago.
Really? This is a long time. This is 10 years after.
Yeah, this is the most recent thing. And then it's... And then you see all this awful stuff with the mosque that was going to be in Lower Manhattan that they're calling the Ground Zero Mosque. It wasn't even a mosque; it was a community center, the Park 51, and all the stuff about Obama being actually a secret Muslim. I mean, it's craziness. I mean, we're out of control. So I think, you know, there's that seems to be stubbornly not progressing as well as it should,
and in
the way that I feel it ought to, towards more compassion and justice and understanding, but. But in general, things do get better, I feel.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say, you know, it goes both. It's sort of like it radiates. It's like sort of good and then like still a little bit of good.
Yeah, it's kind of going in two different
directions. I mean, no one can see this.
No one can see your hand motion. You had your one hand kind of stretching out, representing good, and then bad kind of stretching the other way, but not going quite as fast. So
slower, yes.
Maybe it's a three steps forward, two steps back kind of thing.
Yeah.
Said another way. To that end, I mean, has humankind failed or succeeded? If the report card of Judgment Day happened now, I don't know if I believe in Judgment Day, but whatever, if we stopped it right now and said, man, do you think we've overall failed or overall succeeded?
I think it's hard to say because I don't know what would success look like.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I think to me I think everybody eating would be the first thing.
Yeah, so I would say, like D+ or something. Or D,
D-,
which I think in some ways is passing, but only barely. Yeah, no, I think not everyone eats. I don't think so, because there's killing. We have, you know, we don't have a colony on Mars. I mean, you know, there's lots of things that haven't happened.
A lot of Star Wars kind of things that we don't have yet.
No, I mean, I don't think we've done, we haven't done enough of what we take care of our fellow humans. So I don't think so.
I
wouldn't say failing sounds a little bit too much in the other way. I think not succeeding is probably strong enough.
Or maybe not succeeding fast enough.
Yeah,
maybe it's not going as fast.
I mean, that's
as
sort of similar to like the previous one, I suppose.
I used to kind of skip that question because I was like, well. Are things getting better or worse? It's kind of the same question. I'm like, well, it's not really the same question.
They're in the same vein, but they're different. Yeah,
different questions. When did it all change? Do you feel like there's an inflection point at which point things have gotten better or worse recently? Or, I mean, to your point, was it 9/11? I mean, maybe some things, I mean, you made a whole film about it. I mean, to someone like me, it didn't really seem like I experienced a lot of racism post 9/11, but I did get looks.
Yeah.
Which was the worst of it, but I didn't experience anything I mean.
Well, I mean, there's every range of things, whether it's just slightly treated differently, mm-hmm. or being harassed or worse, right? Mm-hmm. So I mean, it's a wide range. So, but I mean, September 11th obviously is in our lifetime is going to be the most seminal. Hopefully, to this point, been the most seminal change. That's happened.
They call it a singularity, something where you remember where you were when it happened.
Right, yeah. And, but I mean, your question, I guess, is I'm not sure, I guess, what it specifically can refer to. I think that would be, that's the only one that anyone could probably really name in our lifetime for something. I mean, Charlie Sheen is probably a big deal.
Charlie Sheen is probably bigger, I would say.
The meme of today.
Yeah, I would say he's the...
He's a different type of disaster.
A different kind of disaster, an entertaining disaster. you see all these people. The question is, can you make $1 million honestly? But $1 million isn't a lot anymore. I'm fascinated by this idea of people becoming wildly successful. Maybe let's make it specific to Hollywood. Do you see people who become really, really successful? Do you think that they... are doing it honestly, or is there an element of dishonesty or lying, cheating, stealing, whatever you want to call it?
I think people do make it honestly in Hollywood, because I think it's hard to make it that, to become that successful or like super wealthy if you don't have some skill, because there are some ways you can get ahead by nepotism or favoritism or luck. But there is a point where it's like just the metal meets the road. I mean, the rubber meets the road.
Metal can meet the road, too.
Yeah.
That's usually when the tread has worn down to the point where...
Yeah, that's more like...
Then you see sparks.
That's like stagecoach, or like a train.
yeah, that's right. Meets the track, where the metal meets the track.
So I think, yeah, there's probably people who... I don't know how you would do it dishonestly. I guess maybe I'm just naive. I mean, there's probably people who do it all the time. But the people who probably get to the stratospheric level of success, actors excluded, because sometimes people who've gotten to the top have been largely boosted because they look good or because they happen to be in the right place at the right time and they happen to have a couple things fall in their favor. Right. Which, not to fault them, because, you know, they're, God bless, they've managed to do it. But I think for people who are like writers or directors, usually they have to have, and even producers too, they have to have had some of that luck as well, but also had to continuously be rewarded for some success or have done something well. Because it's really hard to last that long and suck.
Right.
I mean, except, I mean, no, because even like if you don't like Jerry Bruckheimer or Michael Bay films, mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. they're huge spectacles. I mean, the storytelling may not be great, but they're really incredible films.
They really are.
And I mean, just production quality wise. So.
Well, I just did a time check, and this is the longest second half I've had.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
No, it's good. I want to keep going, but at the same time, I'm like, you know what? I feel like as we were going through the first part of them, I'm like, oh, we'll be able to get through a lot of them, but I'm like, maybe I'll have you back on the program at a future point or something like that.
A week or something?
Absolutely. But I'm enjoying it so much, but I kind of feel like I'm like, well, I don't want to like steam through the rest of the questions. I mean, maybe it's worthwhile to do like an overtime thing like Bill Maher does where he...
This will just be as entertaining as
further that. Discussion. Yeah, absolutely. But let me ask you this. We'll leave with two questions.
Okay.
One of them is just recap where people can find you again.
So they can go to my website, SharatRaju.com, S-H-A-R-A-T, mm-hmm. S-H-A-R, S-H-A-R-A-T-R-A-J-U.com.
Right.
And, or my newest film is going to be on Future States. That's futurestates.tv. Google's
a good place
Google,
to find everybody.
Facebook, yeah.
Yeah, that's great. That's wonderful. And let me close with this. What are some things you wish you'd known as a kid? I mean, what do you want to tell the kids out there? What's your biggest epiphany? I mean, any advice, any parting words of wisdom? You seem like a wise man.
Yeah, boy, I fooled you.
It's the hair.
It is. It really is.
Yeah. They can't see the hair.
No, they can't. Yeah, I can see it on the Facebook. It's usually much worse than this.
You actually have a similar hair to a friend of mine in Chicago. So there you go.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Do I know who
Rohit
he is?
Chandra. You remind me of Rohit Chandra.
Rohit. I know two Rohits.
There you go.
Thank
you.
Yeah. Neither of them is that. I don't know. That's a good question. I think if I was talking to myself as a child or as a kid, I would probably have told myself that people make movies and you can probably do it if that's what you want. But I think what I probably would say is... do your best to try to do something you really enjoy, which seems very easy to say because it's easy to say for me because I'm doing it. But I think a lot of people, but there are obstacles to that because sometimes you'll have family resistance or you know, money. You just can't do it financially for yourself.
Sure.
Or you can't do it for whatever reasons. But yeah, do something you love. It just makes everything worthwhile. And if you love it and you're doing it, you'll find a way to live and survive and thrive. Yeah.
You'll never work a day in your life,
as they say.
That's exactly right.
That's totally true.
Well, man, yeah, I know. I wish we could go through the rest. They're just your answers are so compelling. And
I just talk a lot. It's a big problem.
That's how I am. If you talk
family,
a lot, people think you know a lot.
Yeah, exactly. We come from a long family of overtalkers.
overachievers. I'm setting expectations low and overachievers.
Exactly. That's what I try to do. You're like, oh, I don't even know if Charlotte's going to show up. And now it's like, oh, we're going
to... is he ever going to leave?
Exactly.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, I lowered expectations.
It'd be like, what is that in Middle East? Sharia law. It's Sharat law. That's
Sharat
what we're, law. We're living
exactly.
under
that's
right now.
That's pulling a Sharat.
That's fantastic. So thank you very much for joining us on the program. It was fantastic to have you on. You were referred by Amin Kadarali,
yes.
Who was, I think, episode 4 or 5. He was a really great interview as well. So
took that long, huh?
I was like, I don't know about this guy. I know. Many episodes later, we reprised the role and... we'll take it from there. But thank you for joining us. I'm talking about myself in the third
person. The royal we, the
plural first person. I better get that right with an English major. This is the Funny Indian Show podcast, episode 33, wrapping up part 2. I've been your host, Rajiv, and I still am.